Attention, thank you. Thank you. Can you hear me okay back there?
Yeah,
good. Thank you. Scott and I did work together many years ago. It was a good reminder to me last night when I was at the reception and I looked around at people that I had known, people that I had come into contact with. It was a great reminder that we're all connected in some way. The people in this room, if you look at the person on your right or your left, that person will be with you for a long time. That's either goodness or not, I know. But one of the benefits of having a conference like this is you can be around other persons from within your industry and you can learn from them and learn about them. They'll come back to you. It was interesting this morning when I came in, I usually try to come a little bit early, and there was a gentleman here, Clifford back there, was the first one here this morning. I worked for a company that I had a president that was a little bit crazy. He gave awards for the first person that came. So Clifford, I have a t-shirt for you later. I felt good about that, by the way, that Clifford was here a little after 7, but he told me one of the reasons he came early is because he wanted that seat in the back in case he wanted to leave early. So sorry about that, Clifford. But this same president, not only did he have award for those that came early, he would have staff meetings at 7 o'clock, and then he'd lock the doors. And if you came after 7 o'clock, you didn't participate. So I became a product of persons that I worked with for a lot of years, and I worked a lot of years in a lot of different places. So when I say I'm looking at the world that's changing, I've lived through that world. And my hope is to share with you this morning some changes that I've seen, some changes that I foresee, and some ways that would allow you to transform yourself and make sure you stay in tune with that change that's occurring. Now, I was given an assignment that said, I need for you to talk about the changing world, what that means to the wireless industry, and how people from within that industry can continue to compete and to future-proof their jobs, which was interesting to me. This is the way I felt when you look out and you try to decide, what are you going to really talk about? So I thought the best thing to do was to talk to persons from within the industry. And so I called some people, some of the leaders that are in this room today, and asked them, what do you think that I ought to cover? One is Joel Hightower. Joel, are you here? You're here. There you are, right there. Thank you. I was impressed. I said, this is my assignment, is to talk about the future of the wireless industry, what that means to the people from within it. What do you think that I need to cover? And it was interesting, his point. He said, I think it's very important. In fact, he reiterated to me this morning, he said, I hope this is good as it should be, because I need to reinforce my people. He does training every week. He does training based upon John Maxwell's maxims about creating emotional maturity. And his point was, I'm trying to create leaders. He has a small business, and he can't be every place all the time. He has to count on his people to be able to be leaders. He has to count on his people to make wise, unemotional, informed decisions. And the way they do that is to receive training. So his point was, I do ongoing training, and my hope is that my people will be able to go to Navy, get additional training, certification, capabilities, so they can continue to be leaders. I was impressed with that. Thank you. I also talked to Ben Little. And for those of you that probably know Ben, know that he is the owner of High Country Solutions. This is a large company, about 400 employees across the country, that does installation for towers. And Ben, if you don't know, has an unusual background. He's like a lot of people in this room. He came from a different industry, and he grew into it. In fact, he went to school to become a veterinarian, ended up being in cranberries and raising cranberries, and built that business and sold it to Ocean Spray. Then he started a high-tech company. And then he started this company that he's in now. And he was excited about the opportunity to have his people attend this session. not necessarily this session, but all of these sessions that Nate in this meeting. And his point was, I want my people to know that there's a career path for them. I want them to know that they can grow from being a climber to a supervisor, to a project manager, to a director. I want them to know that there's a career path out there for them. It's important for them to know that, and I need for you to reinforce the fact that that's the reason for Nate, the reason that they're there. In fact, the story that he told me was interesting. He was talking to his CFO, the person that counts the money, and that person said to him, what if we pay the way for all of these folks, our people, to go to Nate, to go to other places and to get the training? They're not on the job, they're out doing other things, and we do that, and they leave us. They go to work for somebody else. And Ben's response was, what if we don't do it, and they stay? His point was that you need to invest in your people and you need to take care of things. Todd, I probably will pronounce this poorly, Schledaway, the director of Nate, I spoke to him as well and said, what is it you think I need to make sure I cover in the presentation? And he said, safety. I need for the folks to know that we're building a network to help make sure they're safe. At the same time, we need for them to grow, and we need for them to be better than what they have been and be aware of what other career opportunities they have in the certifications. But the common thread to all of that was growth. And my belief is, as the world changes, as the marketplace changes, as the world of work changes, the way you stay with it is that you change too. But those were leaders. And I thought it would be good that I also talk to a climber. And in my lifetime past, I had the opportunity to come to know some climbers. And I called them, and I need to read this to you. I want to make sure that I quote him properly. A number of them said, I can't wait, Bourbon Street will never be the same, and it probably won't be. But this one gentleman, he said, I feel that what I do is unique and important. Some people think and call me a tower dog, but I'm not a dog. I consider myself a professional, doing the best that I can and being the best that I can. And I'm looking forward to going to Nate so I can become what I want to become. So each of the persons I talked to, they were talking about their future, and they were talking about the world that's changing. And therefore, my responsibility, I believe, was to put together something that would allow each of the persons that are attending today and these sessions to be able to become as good as they could become. Now, I need to say, I have a lot of respect for the climbers and the people that are in this room that have helped create dots. Now, Steve Jobs talked about dots in your background, data points. These are dots here, as you can see. Remember when we had just a few towers to begin and those dots represented a tower? And then it ended up growing. And you had other companies that put in towers and coverage around the world till now. The world's covered. I believe that the things that you're involved in, the things that the climbers do, is one of the great American sagas of the world. That the world is continuing to grow, and in this way, you're providing coverage to the world. I have great respect for the people that have accomplished that. I also believe it's a unique position. Now, I need to be careful, because I know there's probably some pictures here that will make some people crazy, but if you look at those pictures, and you look at the things that are there, people do that. It's wild, I know. For those of you that can't see, those are snakes that are partway up a tower. And I think it's a great metaphor for what's happening sometimes in a number of tower situations where failure is not an option. There are problems that need to be managed. There are things that need to be taken care of. It's kind of like an Apollo 13. when they were returning to Earth and they were having problems, and the only way they could fix it was with the duct tape that they had. I think there's a lot of duct tape that sometimes happens on a tower site. But you can't walk away. There are times, as a salesperson, as a manager, I don't complete a job sometimes, and I can walk away. But if you're working on a tower, failure is not an option. It has to be taken care of. Also, for those that are 2,000 feet in the air, the courage that it takes to do that. And then this one, I debated whether or not I should put something in there. A woman on a tower with a climber. But it was a great reminder to me that when we had crews and they were out there, they weren't by themselves. They still had what they had, their family with them in their mind. They were working in a motel in a pickup truck and living there, and they had other persons that they were responsible for and persons they had to take care of. So I just want you to know that I have great respect for the people that are from within this industry and the things you do. I think it's significant, and I wanted to talk about those things. But I also wanted to talk about the changing world, because the things that we're involved with are changing significantly. If you look, for example, at the cell phone, when I first started, I worked for IBM most of my life, and one of the great technologies they gave us was a bag phone. We had a phone that was in a bag that communicated with a satellite. That was the way I could communicate. Later, that transformed itself into a brick that I could take with me, to a point now where you have this cell phone that has more power than computers we used to sell that had raised floors and dedicated staffs. But if you look at what's happening and the changes that are taking place, the world is still changing significantly. The world, in fact, there are more cell phones in the world right now than there are people. More cell phones than the number of people. In fact, when I did the research, I found that in Russia, there's 1.8 cell phones per person. I don't know why, might be a vodka thing, I'm not sure, but the number of cell phones is increasing significantly. And if you look in the out years to what's going to happen, some of the things that I've read were there's going to be a chip that would be embedded in your ear for communications that would be sound actuated. And then they talk about hologram kinds of screens. You know, the Iron Man screen that you can move things around, that they're saying that's on. There's a company called Frog that's creating those as well. So the world's changing. I know here that there are booths with drones in them. One of my clients is a company that has drones and produces the ability to survey and communicate with different parts of the tower. And they'll be able to send the drone up for 1,000 feet to be able to change a light bulb. They're able to go out in the large wind towers on the tips of those blades and be able to read the serial number to see if there's any damage. The world is changing, and my expectation and intent is to talk about ways that you folks can be able to stay on the front edge of that as well. And that's when I talk about looking through your windshield versus your rear view mirror. The windshield's much bigger, and I want to make sure that you continue to look forward. But the world continues to change. In a lifetime past, persons of my age, when I went to work for IBM, the intent was that you would work there for life, your business life, and then when you retired, you would get a pension. Not anymore. The way the world is now, people are more involved in a purpose rather than working for someone on a full-time basis. My need was having a good boss that would take care of us. Today, it's the colleagues, the people that you work with. The hours were 9 to 5, and the workplace was in an office. I would get up and drive for an hour to sit in an office, and do my work, and then go home, and the next day, do the same thing in the same place. Today, The place and the time is wherever and whenever. For a lot of you that work out of your homes, you work on the road, you work in the street. By the street, I mean working in terms of being able to take care of businesses. And the tenure, it used to be you worked for somebody forever now, but the tenure is short term. In fact, some of the people talk now about the way the world's going to become, and potentially there won't be companies. That everybody will have their own brand. And that if there's a requirement for your kind of capability, then they'll pull you in for a team to take care of a specific project. I have some clients right now that are saying, I don't need somebody to work for me full time. I need people that look like this because I need to create a team to be able to go take care of this project. And when it's over, it's over. So the world is changing. And my purpose is just to give you an idea of some of the things that are happening to make sure you're on the front end of that. So when the world changes, how do you manage that, take care of that? I usually go back to some of my old philosophers like Yogi Berra, who said it's tough to make predictions, especially about the future. And it is, because who knows what tomorrow is going to be. But I also like when he says, if you come to a fork in the road, take it. I believe you take action. I know that wasn't what he meant at the time, but I do believe that whatever occurs, you need to take action. And then there's Darwin, and his point was, it is not the strongest of the species that survive, nor the most intelligent, but the one that's most responsive to change. The industry is changing, your industry is changing, the world is changing, and for those of you that can recognize what's happening and understand what the opportunities are, my belief is that you'll be out in front of the rest of the world. Some companies didn't do that. If you look at some of these folks, they didn't see the world changing, and they didn't reinvest. So if you look at Blockbuster and what happened to them, and what's happening to Sears before our eyes, Kodak, where you would have this small camera with a cube on it, and you would take a picture, and then you would take the film out, and you would take it into the store and mail it in, and a week later that you get your pictures. Now, what do? You take the picture, you send it to somebody, and it's done immediately. The world's changing. Companies haven't changed, some of them, and it's within your industry as well. Because they didn't change, it was fatal. So what do? My belief is you take the first step. And for those of you in this room, and for those of you that are attending this conference, you've already taken the first step, which is to invest in yourself, I believe. The answer is to be as good as you can be. I talk to people every day that are seeking something, and they're looking to be able to invest their future, excuse me. Some of them say, I wish I could go back. But I hate to tell you this, you can't go back. You can't go back to high school and be the homecoming queen or king. You can't go back. There's some things you can't go back and change. Even though it was interesting, they did a survey of people that were in a rest home, and they said, if you could go back, what would you change? And the top thing was, I wish I would have had more fun. I wish I would have been happier. I wish I would have taken time to do a lot of more fun things. But you can't go back. Again, Steve Jobs talks about data points. You need to look back and be aware of what happened, but you need to go forward. And in my opinion, and the opinion of a lot of good people, it is you need to do something today that your future self will thank you for. Your future self. You're doing that right now. You're attending this conference and a lot of sessions that would help you build on your capabilities. I believe that's the answer. So how do you take that leap? What do you do? What specific things could you do to help future-proof your job, your career, your chosen time in the business world. One of the first things I think you need to do is understand your skills. Analyze your skills. A SWOT analysis: strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. I've done this in a number of businesses where I work. We would get the team together and talk about, what are we? What are our strengths? What are our weaknesses? What are we doing well and what are we not? And what do we need to do different? And I'll talk more in a minute about how you can do that for yourself. But I speak to a number of professional people. And one of the things we talk about is, what are you good at? What is your competitive advantage? What can you do that other people cannot, that we could present you to a company that would create interest from them? So one, create a SWOT analysis. You get input from others to do that. We'll talk about how you can do that in a minute. And then build a career plan. Short, medium, and long. What do you want to do? Now that you know what your strengths are, what is your plan that you would put in place? But do it proactively and create an action plan that goes with that. And let's talk about that a little bit. You may not be able to see all this, but this is the matrix. And this works for an individual, this works for a company. And as I work with people and help professionals move forward in their career, this is one of the things we talk about. And we have them go through this. What are you good at? What are your strengths? Are you technical? Are you good with people? Do you like being out in the business world? Do you like meeting with people? What is it that you're good at? At the same time, what are your weaknesses? And some people will say, I'm not as technical as I should be, but I know it's needed. You need to make note of that. Or they say, I get by on relationships. I'm a technical person. I can do an Excel spreadsheet, and it's great, but I have a difficult time working with other people. What are the weaknesses? What are the things that you know of? Get input from others as well. Other people will give you input about who you are and what they see as your strengths and your weaknesses. But also, what are the opportunities that you see? That could be within a company, and that could be with you as an individual. What are the opportunities that you see for yourself? And what are the threats that might be there? What's going to happen if the company you work for goes out of business? What's going to happen if your industry doesn't move forward? What happens if this build-out doesn't take place? What happens if you pull a muscle and you're unable to do something? What is it about you? So you need to create this profile for yourself based upon your input that you know to be true about yourself and others, because others look at you in a different way. The purpose of that is to drive the threats, the opportunities, and the weaknesses and do something about them and turn them into strengths. Malcolm Gladwell wrote a book called David and Goliath. And one of his great stories was about David, who was a warrior. He was a warrior. And he was sent into battle. And on the other side was Goliath, a huge man with a huge sword. It was a big threat, but it was an opportunity for him. And he had some strengths, and his strengths were he was fast, and he had the ability to throw a rock. He had a lot of strengths, and he was smart. And he competed, and he defeated Goliath. He knew what he was, he knew what he wasn't, and he made sure that he had the ability to take care of things. It was just, we had, at lunchtime, we have the coach for the local football team here, the Saints, and we had the Super Bowl recently. And if you think about it, the quarterbacks that they had, Carolina's quarterback was 6'5", 250 pounds, big, strong, fast. And then Peyton Manning, who's slow, old, can't throw, but he knew what his strengths were. He knew what his weaknesses were. And he found a way to compete and win. My recommendation is that you do the same. It's also interesting that people have frailties and weaknesses. Here's a list of presidents that had dyslexia. Henry Ford had dyslexia as well. The president of Virgin Airlines has dyslexia. But what they ended up doing is they took that frailty and even though they had to read backwards and read slowly, what they discovered is they went so slowly reading that their comprehension was significant. They learned things that other people couldn't learn. And it was a great revelation to me that if you talk about taking threats or weaknesses that you have, finding a way to turning it into something significant, you can do that. And my recommendation is that you take a look at yourself as well. And once you've established who you are and what you are, then create a plan. Cheshire Cat, who said, "Would you tell me please where I ought to go from here? That depends a good deal on where you want to get to," said the cat. I don't much care where," said Ahlstrom. "It doesn't matter much which way you go, does it?" I talk to people all the time. When I ask them, "What's your career objective?" they don't know. They want a job, which is important, and it's a practical way to do it. But they're not sure what their career plan is and what they want, short term and long term. And my opinion is that you need to create one. Once you know what your weaknesses are, what your strengths are, how can you build on that? And what would that action plan look like? This is more information than you need, probably. But what I want to do is just talk about the major sections of this. On the left-hand side, you talk about who are you? You just created a profile about yourself. Who are you? What are your strengths and what are your weaknesses? What's your education? Where have you been working? What's important to you? What are your values? What are your limitations? That's what who you are. But then to look at it is, what do you want to accomplish in the short term? Is your next step, you want to be a project manager? You want to be a manager at all? It was interesting. One company I talked to one of their salespeople, and I said, "What do you want to do?" He said, "I want to become president of my division." I talked to the president of their division. I said, "What do you want to do?" He said, "I want to go back and be a salesman because there's too much pain being the president of this company." Everybody needs to understand where you want to go. Short term, mid term, long term. And that's where you want to go from a career standpoint and in your personal life. My recommendation is that you take a look at those things. It doesn't need to be complex, but you got to think about that. This is your life. You are the pilot. It's important that you stay in command. What are your current competencies and your skills and your knowledge, and where does that fit? And then what are your developmental needs? When you looked at your weaknesses, you identified some things you needed to be. And I say, do something about it. Become an expert in something. Become an expert in something. I talk to people every day, and I ask them, what is it that you're an expert at? And they don't always know. So I know that there are some companies that sometimes make changes, and they ask an employee to leave. Seldom is it the person that's the expert. Seldom is it the person that has the best relationships with all of their clients. Seldom is it the person that everyone recognizes as being the best. So I believe you become an expert at something and be able to create who you are as best you can be and put an action plan in place. If you decide one of the things you want to do is become more knowledgeable, more technical, and therefore you want to learn more about Excel, then attend a class. And these sessions that are here are significant that you have the opportunity to learn from. My point is, understand what your strengths are and your weaknesses. Understand what you need, how you need to grow, and then put together a plan on what you really want, short-term, mid-term, long-term. Also, in terms of future-proofing yourself from within your career, I'm saying you keep track of what's going on in the world. You know, it's the frog that's in the water that's boiling and doesn't know it until they're dead and it's over. You need to keep track of what's going on. It's hard for me to say that. I came here this morning. I didn't know. Apparently last night there were a lot of tornadoes and weather problems in the world. I should keep track of that kind of thing. But this is a great way to do this. The current the profession that you've chosen at this point in time, it may not be forever, but for this point in time, this is where you've chosen to invest your time. And this is a great place to do it. The professional people that you're around, the organization that you're in, the industry that you're in, you'll have an opportunity to go out here, to go to the booths when you're finished and be able to talk to the people about what's going on. You're going to be able to see it here. This is like a textbook on what could be for you if you choose that. So keep track of what's going on in the world and the technology that's affecting your industry. I saw a book, there was a book sitting on a table out here about drones. And I have one of my clients, by the way, the gentleman owns a company that what they do is they have drones that inspect towers. And he said, what I'm looking for is I need someone who has a pilot's license that understands our industry and towers and poles and is good at video games, because I need for them to be able to control this drone and take care of things. So maybe if I do my planning, I say, I know towers, I'm good at video games, I need to get my pilot's license. The world is changing. And I'm just saying, be aware of what those changes are and align yourself with those changes where it makes sense. World dynamics, the world's changing. Fracking, what's happening in Canada? What's happening, what did happen in North and South Dakota? What's happening in Cuba? With that opening up, just be aware of what's going on in the world and within your industry. It'll help you decide what's right for you, because that's your purpose. I'm just saying, don't walk into the future blindfolded. Be aware of what's taking place and then make wise choices based upon your capacity to understand the things that are important to you. Keep learning and grow professionally. That's what this is all about. I believe it should be your top priority. The things, the sessions that are available today, if you look through the book, it's an opportunity to learn additional things. There's people that you're gonna learn, that you will learn from. The technology, it's all here. And I listed some of those, the videos, the certifications, the National Wireless Safety Allowance, the fall protection classes, the industry best practices, etc. You know what they are. My point is, there are opportunities from within your industry for training. This is that opportunity. Your company felt strongly enough about you to pay you to come here and to do this. Use that opportunity, invest in yourself while you're here. I just put in the World Wide Web. It's unbelievable, the stuff that's in there. It's unbelievable. You could go in there and ask it a question. I want to know more about climbing safety. There's over 1 million responses. I want to know about towers. I want to know about XL. I want to know about the changing world of wireless. I want to know about drones. It's all there. It's available to you. It used to be, you could say, I didn't get the memo about that opportunity. It's there in front of you. And I just, XL as an example, there are a lot of other examples of areas where you could grow professionally and in terms of capability. And you'll know that if you look at yourself, you look at, do your SWOT analysis, understand what the opportunities are, build your plan, you'll know those classes and those certifications that you need. But do it. Do it. And then get connected. One of the things we talked about is the world of the future is going to be one of a fragmented group of people that have created their own brand, that have a capability that they've described that's online that people will pull in and pull together. I'm serious. Companies that call me and say, I need a team of people that look like this. I have to find those people. And the way you do it is to find people through their strengths and capabilities and experience. And one of the ways you're able to do and get connected and be involved is through organizations like Nate. You'll be able to meet those people today when you go through the training and the people in the hallways and the people in the booths where they'll have story. Everybody has a story. Everybody has a product line. Everybody has a solution. Know who and what that is. Your colleagues, the person to your right and the person to your left. I haven't seen Scott in years, but I talk to him periodically. But when you come around, there'll be people that will come back in your life over and over again that will help you, and you'll help them. Mentors. I've been fortunate where I've had some people in my life that I could go to lunch with once a month or be around somebody that I admired, and I would say, get a mentor. Someone that you admire, someone that's bigger than you, that you could talk to about what is it that you think is important? What about these kinds of things? How can I help you? How can you help me? Get a mentor that can help work with you. It's a great response. And community organizations. I know a lot of you travel and it's difficult. I try to be a member of Rotary on a number of occasions, but then you have to be there on an X period of time, and I was traveling, I couldn't do it. But community organizations, I've been fortunate to be involved in a number of them, inside and outside the United States, and it's comforting to know that there's something bigger than you, and it's good to know that you're investing your life that is helpful to other people. Give back to other folks. And LinkedIn. I just use LinkedIn as an example. It used to be that you had to have a resume. Talked about, should you have a 5-page resume? Should you have a 1-page resume? How much should you put on there? Should you put the dates on there? Should you put titles? All the things that go with it. The resume of today is LinkedIn. People in my business, people in other businesses, if they want someone, they'll go to LinkedIn many times and say, I'm looking for somebody that has these skills and this capability. And they'll contact that person and they'll reach out to them. I'm assuming most of you are on LinkedIn. If you aren't, you gotta think about it. But the point is, get connected. And then I say, remember Groundhog Day. An opportunity to see Bill Murray a couple weeks ago. He was playing in Pebble Beach. He's a crazy man. But he's been involved in some great movies, one of which is Groundhog Day. And I know that you're saying, what's the object lesson from Groundhog Day? Think about it. This is a man that changed his world based upon how he conducted himself. Every day, he did something a little bit different. He would live through a situation until he got to a point where he screwed it up. And he figured out, what could I do differently? Could I be nicer? Could I be more knowledgeable? Could I be more capable? What is it that I could do that would make it different? And he did that. Each day he went out and he was nicer and he was better and he was more knowledgeable. And he changed the world based upon the way he conducted himself and the way he presented himself. And I believe that's true. I believe that every day you have an opportunity. Every day you're going to have an interaction. Every day something is going to happen where you have an opportunity to make it better and make it good. And I believe that Bill Murray is a great reminder of that. And the end story was, for him at least, that by being able to create a world of goodness and conducting himself in the way he chose to and wanted to, that the outcome was significant for him, and he ended up creating a world for himself that was one that was goodness for him. So to future-proof your career, a lot of people I talk to, they say, I'm looking for a way that I know that I will have a job tomorrow. I want to make sure that it was, I invest my time every day, that I know it's a great investment of my time. And the answer is, what we talk about is future-proofing their careers. And I believe the answer is multiples. One, understand what your strengths are and your weaknesses. Do something about it. B, Be as good as you can be. Have a plan. Make sure you follow that plan. Make sure you know what's going on in the world. Monitor the environment. What's happening? What are the things that are affecting you, affecting those around you, and those within the industry? What's happening? Stay connected. Stay connected to the people in this room, within your industry, and outside. If you choose to be involved in something else, someplace else, get connected. But learn and grow professionally. Become an expert on something. Be as good as you can be where you are. And remember Groundhog Day, that the interactions you have every day, can create great outcomes if you choose for it to be that way. But my daughter reminds me many times what all of this, the result really is to be happy. Don't get crazy. My granddaughter tells me, don't get crazy, Grandpa. Don't get crazy. Be happy. And I need to do that because sometimes I get so wound up in taking care of people, taking care of my responsibilities, taking care of the things that are in front of me. I don't take care of the things that I should to be happy. It's just as a reminder. So I want to tell you this story. I know this man, I've seen him before. He was on vacation. He worked for an equity firm in New York. He's on vacation in Mexico. And he has his cup of coffee, and he goes down to the pier in the morning, and while he's there, up to the pier comes a Mexican fisherman in a boat, has a couple of yellowfin tuna in his boat. And the guy from New York says, nice fish. Beautiful fish. He said, how long did it take you to catch those fish? He said, not very long. He says, well, why don't you go back out and catch a bunch more? He says, no, this is all I need to take care of my family. I'm happy. He says, well, why don't you go out and catch some more? He says, what are you going to do all day? He says, I don't need any more. He says, what I'm going to do, every day I sleep late, I fish a little, I play with my children, take siestas with my wife, stroll into the village each evening where I sip wine, play guitar with my amigos. The guy said, well, you know, think about it though. If you go back out the rest of the day, catch more fish, pretty soon you'll be able to buy another boat. And then you'll be able to have two boats and you can have them loaded with fish. So then be able to move to Mexico City and you can have a fleet. And then you can move to New York. And you'll be able to create a dynasty because you will be able to have a fleet of boats and cut out the middleman and be able to sell these fish, thousands of them. He said, and the Mexican said, well, then what? He said, well, then what you'll do is be able to sell your business and you'll make millions of dollars. He said, how long will that take? 15 or 20 years. He said, well, then after I sell my business, then what do I do with my millions? He said, well, you'll be able to sleep late, fish a little, play with your children, take siestas, go to the town and play with your amigos. So, there's nobody you know that will advise you other than to be everything you can be and be practical and take care of your career. It's important. It's important to you. It's important to your family. It's an important part of your being. But be careful you don't be too consumed. Your real objective is to be happy and to be honest with yourself about what is truly important. You might find that it might be a little bit closer to yourself than what you thought it could be. So, my purpose was to help you understand that there's a world out there that's changing, not only within the wireless industry, but throughout the hemisphere. And I talk to those people every day. Some are companies looking for people, some are people looking for companies, and I try to match up the best. But I believe the answer is to be the best you can be. And have a plan and to take care of yourself and you'll be fine. You have leaders like Joel, like Ben, that have companies that care about you and that are investing in helping you make that happen. We're fortunate to have that. It's the world that's dedicated to you, and I say take advantage of that. So, therefore, go forward, do good, avoid evil at all things. Thank you. So, if there are questions, I'd like to answer any questions you might have. Okay? There are no questions, so I say thank you very much for coming. Enjoy your day. Go out and invest in yourself the remainder of the time. Thank you.